quasi-free electron model to the case of the aluminum crystals. The example we will discuss is aluminum, which crystallizes in FCC lattice. And we will apply the quasi, we electron model to calculate the band structure along one direction, asymmetric direction. So aluminum is has an atomic number 13, and its electronic configuration in the atom is that of neon, so a noble gas, so from the full shell of the last column of the periodic table. And then in the valence we have two 3s electrons and one 3p electron. So it has 3 valence electrons. So this is what the case we will examine with the quasi-free electron model today. Now, I'm showing here some calculated band structure. These are accurate calculations, numerical calculations for 3 different systems, aluminum, calcium, and sodium. Aluminum, as I mentioned, has 3 electrons in the unit cell, and it focuses, it crystallizes, sorry, in the FCC structure. So this is the top band structure. What is shown is the band structure along some high symmetry direction of the aluminum Brillouin zone. So on the next page, in the back of what I distributed, you have also the Brillouin zone. The first one is that of a BCC crystal, and the second one is that of an FCC crystal. So for aluminum, it is the second type. It's a truncated octahedron. The Brillouin zone for the FCC lattice. So in the band structure, the plots are made along some of these high symmetry directions, like gamma x. The x point is here, so this is one of the directions from the Brillouin zone center to this square, the center of this square facet. And then there are also some other directions which are shown in the band structure of aluminum. So the dashed line in the figure corresponds to the Fermi energy. So this is the first case, aluminum. The second case is calcium. This crystallizes in an FCC structure also, but it has 2 electrons per unit cell. So same type of direction of the along the inside the Brillouin zone. And the third example is sodium. This crystallizes in the BCC structure. It is an alkali metal, 1 electron per unit cell. And Okay, so these band structures are from accurate numerical calculations using density functional theory, and these band structures are consistent, agree well also with photo emission experiment. So with the experimental situation. Now, what you can notice first is that for sodium, so this is the Fermi energy, and as I mentioned, the free electron model works very well for the alkali metal, so sodium in particular. It's a half filled band situation, so you have the parabolic band of the free electron that is partially filled here, and it's all the interesting or all the important states for the physical properties of the system are well inside the Brillouin zone in the region where the band is parabolic, where there are no splitting, and it behaves like a free electron system. So this is the case of sodium. Okay? Now, and the Brillouin zone in this case is the first one, so it's that of the VCC lattice. So in this case, they were looking at the gamma H direction and some other direction from the center here of the Brillouin zone. And these are region Hn on the edge of the Brillouin zone. This corresponds to regions where they are no field state at the edge of the Brillouin zone. Okay, so this is for sodium. Now calcium has two electrons per unit cell. So there it's very different from a free electron system because the splitting occurs in the important region where there is the Fermi energy. So in some cases you can see that the lowest band is the Fermi energy caps the first band. But in other places, like in this region, maybe I can show it. Okay, not really. So if you look at the L point, you can see that the Fermi energy cuts actually the second band. So it is very messy. It's very different from a free electron behavior because of the splittings that occur not far away from the Fermi energy or at the Fermi energy. So this behaves very differently from a free electron system, and as I mentioned, this is a bad metal. A metal with a low density of state at the Fermi energy. So this is for calcium. And finally, the top one is aluminum. So there are overall, let's say, three band filled, but under the Fermi energy is somehow above most of the splittings. I mean, it's because the Fermi energy is higher with respect to the lowest band. And this is the case that we will examine today. So what we will do is calculate the band structure along the gamma x direction, so the first panel here, and we will also examine the splitting at the x point for this band structure. Okay. Any question? Yes.
Why there is negative energy on the anion?
The energy absolute value is not well defined in a solid. In the sense, it's arbitrary. What is meaningful are the energy difference, in particular with respect to the Fermi energy. But in an infinite crystal, there is no way to, there is no zero of energy in the sense that if you have some vacuum, you can measure the energy inside your crystal with respect to the potential outside. But if the full space is occupied, like in a crystal, the zero of energy is not well defined. There is no, you can define relative energies in the band structure, but there is no way to define the zero of energy that is not arbitrary. In order to define, for instance, the energy you need to extract an electron, you need to have a surface and some vacuum. And then the energy that is needed will depend on which surface of the crystal you are considering. So the zero of energy is not well defined in a crystal, it's arbitrary. Usually what one does is one puts the zero of energy of the Fermi energy. It's an arbitrary choice, but...
This is not the case here.
No, it's not the case here, but it's arbitrary. There is no physical meaning in the absolute value of the energy.
Does it give us any information when we have negative energy or positive energy?
I mean, in general, when you have a surface, these energies are below the Fermi energy, and the field bands are below the vacuum, the zero of energy, if you want, the vacuum potential. So, yes, in general, when you have a surface, these energies are below the vacuum level, you need some energy to remove an electron from the system and put it far away in the vacuum, and to put it at the zero of energy.
So we can...
Okay. This all comes from long-range potential that exist in the system, Coulomb potential, which, if you have a potential which is short-range, then by superposition of this type of potential, you can define an average value which will be the same if you have an infinite superposition or just a finite one, sufficiently large to, morph and tree, in order to make an average. It's something, all right. If you have some potentials which are of that type, around the atoms, you can define an average value, and then it will not depend if you have just a few or an infinite number. This average value is well defined with respect to the vacuum potential. The problem of Coulomb potentials is that they are long range, and therefore you cannot define an average value with respect to the vacuum potential when you superpose an infinite or a finite number of these potentials. So there is a divergence in the average potential that comes from the long-range nature of the Coulomb potential. So in a crystal, the only way to measure the energy inside the crystal with respect to the vacuum is to have a surface, so you have a finite you have different faces of your crystal, let's say the 100 or the 111 face of the crystal, and then along one of these faces you can measure the energy that is required to remove an electron and to put it in the vacuum, but it will depend on which surface you choose. So there is no way to have a bulk value of the Wolf function, for instance, in a crystal. It will depend on the surface you choose.
Maybe this is a little stupid question. So this comes from the, when we choose our potential in the free electron, the semi-free electron model, we choose V1 over 2 cosine 2 pi over A, something like this, X. And it is this V1 that really gives the value.
Yes. There is something I alluded in the sense that I told you that we put the average potential as zero. But actually this is the tricky part, in the sense this value is ill-defined. It's a constant, but how much it is ill-defined with respect to the vacuum. So with respect to this average, you can define the variation. Everything relative is fine. The problem is that you cannot give an absolute value to an energy in the crystal, because in order to do that, you need a reference outside the crystal, the vacuum potential, but if you have an infinite crystal, a periodic system, there is no vacuum. So that's the complication. In the case where one has short-range potentials, that is, one doesn't have the Coulomb potential due to the nuclei and the electronic charge, then there is a way to define a robust average potential which will not depend if there is vacuum or not. But this is not true when one has charged particles, and therefore for a crystal there is no way to define, you have your band structure, you have your energy of the crystal, let's say this is the Fermi energy, and then you have your band structure around the Fermi energy, I don't know, it can be anything you want. So all this energy with respect to the Fermi energy are well defined. All the relative energy, the band structure, you can measure with respect to the Fermi energy anything you want, it's well defined. But the absolute value of this with respect to the vacuum potential is not is ill-defined. That's and this the reason for this comes from the long-range nature of the Coulomb potential. I mean the long-range nature of the potential associated to the charged particles in the crystal. Okay, so I deviated a bit, but the reference value has no physical meaning. Only the relative values in a band structure have a meaning. All right, so,
I
confused you because I didn't want to go into this. So everything is fine with respect to an average potential. I mean, again, in the in the crystal, what I was showing, you can you can have an average potential again and measure everything with respect to this reference in your crystal. This is also fine. So the average potential, I have it in the crystal. What I cannot do is measure it with respect to the vacuum potential. This is ill-defined. However, there is an average potential in the crystal, and I can also measure my band structure relative to this average potential. And I can, and around this average potential, I can also measure the oscillation, the periodic oscillation that are that correspond to the true potential. So all this is fine. All relative energies are fine. The problem is the absolute value.
Yeah, and you know, my question is if it's different. It's maybe it will take us back a little, but this band structure is for one electron per unit cell. So I mean, for sodium, it's one electron per unit cell. And does this mean that this applies to just that unit cell, or?
What do you mean? I didn't understand.
Is there any translation that has been done, or this is just for that particular unit cell? This is the band structure.
This is the band structure calculated for potential. Corresponding to sodium. In a BCC arrangement. So this is, if you want, it's essentially what you should expect experimentally for the sodium crystal, the electronic band structure. Okay, this was calculated. What I showed you so far was the plane wave method, which would be a rather general method to calculate band structure. And I mentioned that one can obtain Fourier coefficient of the crystal potential that are what is needed for to calculate the band structure. So this is what I showed you. Now, in practice, one can obtain the potentials from the atoms. That is the potentials that will act on the valence electron in the crystal can be obtained from calculations for the atom. There is a way to unscreen in the atom the potential that is obtained self-consistently. This is going to be discussed later on in the course, and to obtain a potential acting on the valence electron of the crystal. So in the calculation, one would have what one will call a pseudo potential that for a given atom like sodium, and then one would place this pseudo potential on each side of the crystal to build the crystal potential, and one would solve then, for instance, with the plane wave method, the problem diagonalize. So, but it's a bit, I didn't mention it yet. I will talk in the next couple of lectures about this a bit. So, there are ways, starting from the method that I presented, to calculate the band structure in a very accurate manner that is in agreement with experiment. There are two methods actually that are called pseudo-potential method that are done with a plane wave basis related to the plane wave method that I showed you. One which was used in the 60s to calculate the band structure of semiconductor, which is called the empirical pseudo-potential method, where one fits these Fourier coefficients, just a few of them, of the crystal potential from the experimental gap at some high symmetry point of the Brillouin zone, and then one can calculate from that the band structure everywhere in the Brillouin zone. And there is another method which is called the ab initio pseudo-potential method. In that case, it's ab initio, it's in the sense it's just it's without experimental input, experimental parameter, that is, one solves the Schrödinger equation for the atoms, and from that one extracts a pseudo-potential that then one uses to carry out the calculation of the crystal. So this is called ab initio pseudo-potential method, and this is similar to what has been used here. Okay? All right, sorry. All right, so now let's go back. So basically you can consider these are very accurate band structure calculation numerical that agree well with experiment and these are from ab initio calculations. And we will do something simpler, but that is analytical, so the positive electron method, to try to reproduce some of these features. So, all right, so this will be for aluminum, so now I'm going to change which is the level. Blackboard. For aluminum. So what we will do, what is our goal, is to determine the band structure for aluminum along the gamma x direction. So this is, there is hope that with the quasi-free electron model one will obtain something relatively reasonable. Given that for the alkali metal like sodium, it seemed to agree quite well with the free electron model,
the accurate calculations compared to what one could expect from a simple model. Okay, so band structure of aluminum along the gamma x direction, so we need the lattice parameter of aluminum. So lattice parameter is 4 angstrom, it's 4.05 angstrom. The lattice parameter of aluminum, so it has an FCC cell, and this is the length of the cube. And since it's FCC, the structure of aluminum, the reciprocal lattice will be BCC, body center cubic. The volume of the unit cell for the FCC lattice is 1/4 a cube. There are 4 aluminum per cubic units per cubic cell, so 1/4 a cube. And therefore, the volume of the Brillouin zone will be 2 pi cube over omega, which is from there 4 times 2 pi cube divided by a cube. So these are the data for aluminum. Now the reciprocal lattice we know that it's a BCC lattice, so the reciprocal lattice will have points at the like this at the edges of the cube, and one at the center of the cube, and one can show easily that this is a cube in reciprocal space that has a length here 4 pi over a. This is because if I calculate, well, one can show it easily, that is, if I calculate the volume per lattice point, assuming this length, volume per lattice point, I will get 1/2, because it's a BCC, so 1/2 of 4 pi over a cube. So if I assume this length, the volume per lattice point will be 1/2 4 pi over a cube, and this actually is exactly what I expect for the volume of the Brillouin zone of the for this FCC lattice of aluminum. That is, this is exactly the volume of the Brillouin zone. So this shows that in reciprocal space, this is the length of the cube, okay? Because based on this length, I obtain exactly what I want for the volume of the Brillouin zone of the aluminum FCC lattice. All right, so now we know what is the reciprocal lattice and what is the lattice parameter in the reciprocal space for this system. And I will now write the unit cell, some unit cell, or let's say primitive vector in real space and then in reciprocal space. So in real space,
The aluminum is FCC, so I have this type of cells. So these are the aluminum atoms on the corner of, at the edges of the cube, and then on each face of the cube I have an additional atom. So and they are kind of on the bottom face, this one, and on this back face also, and then this one also here. So the big ones are on the front faces, the visible faces. Okay, so these are the aluminum atoms, and for the primitive vectors, I can use the vector that point to the face centered atoms, so A1 here, for instance, A2 and A3. So this would be A1, A2, and this is A3. So I choose this as my primitive vectors for the aluminum FCC lattice. So this is 1/2, 1/2, 0, A. A2 is equal to 0, 1/2, 1/2, A, and A3 is equal to 1/2, 0, 1/2, A. So these are my primitive vectors in real space. And in a reciprocal space corresponding to these primitive vectors, in reciprocal space I have this lattice, and the B vector should be some vectors that point to the to the point at the center of the cube. They are eight of this cube around the origin, and the one that are the B vector related to this A vector that verify AI times BG equal to pi delta IG, they are B1. So B1 is equal to 1, 1, -1, 2π/A. B2 is equal to -1, 1, 1, 2π/A. And B3 is equal to 1, -1, 1, 2π/A. So these three vectors are vectors that point to some of the atoms, to some of the point at the center of the of some cube around the origin. So the first one points to the cube that is below this one.
at the center, it's half the diagonal of the half the distance of the diagonal. Sorry, it points to this atom and to the lattice point here. So Antoine can verify that Bi times Aj is equal to 2 pi delta Ij. These are the primitive vector of the reciprocal lattice associated with this A vector in real space. Okay. All right. So these are for the to set the real space of the lattice and reciprocal lattice. And now we have to get the coordinate of the x point, which is the point we were interested in. So if I look at the Brillouin zone of aluminum, I want the coordinates of this point x, I mean one of these points that is at the center of the face, square face of the cube, and I want it in the xy, the kx, ky plane. So if I draw here the kx and ky axis, so I'm in the horizontal plane of the Brillouin zone, I have the gamma point here, and then let me draw this a bit longer. So let's say I have the lattice point here that would be 4 pi over a zero. So along the okay, in the reciprocal space, this is my first lattice point here, which is at the distance from the origin 4 pi over a. So this is this lattice point here, and then I have okay, another one here. Okay, and the point x is actually at half that distance. The point x is on the face that is the bisecting plane that of the segment going to from this point to this point. It's on the face, bisecting face that is facing the second nearest neighbor of the BCC lattice. So the coordinate of my point x here are 2 times pi over a, so it's at half that distance. And if I wanted to draw actually fully I would have a cube. Okay. So I would have here in the plane the intersection with the square face. The same here. The same here. And the same here. And so this is the X point. And here I will have what in the Brillouin zone here is labeled as the point K. I mean, equivalent to this point K, there are other point Ks that that are at the intersection between two hexagonal faces. So there is a point K here, one point K here that is in the horizontal plane, and one point K here. So here we would have also a point equivalent to that capital K that would have as coordinate 3/2, 3/2 pi over A. Okay, I mean, this is just geometry. It's not important, this, what I just want is this point X. This is what is relevant for what I will do next. So this is just the section of the Brillouin zone in the horizontal plane. In green, I guess. Just for orientation. So this is the section of the Brillouin zone that is in the kx, ky plane. And we are interested in this point, x, and we want to look at the band structure along this line gamma x. So this is the point gamma at the center of the Brillouin zone.
So
yes.
Just to make it clear for me, the gamma point,
yes,
that we painted corresponds to the central atom, central point on the wrist of the lattice.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Not that the one in the center or in the corner.
It doesn't matter. Everything is the good thing with Bravais lattice is that you can any point is equivalent to any other point in the Bravais lattice. You can always translate everything by a Bravais lattice vector and you are in the same equivalent case. Okay? And the Brillouin zone is just a Wigner site, so around a specific point, but you can choose anyone you want. Okay, all right, so now we have our reciprocal space on the gamma x direction, and the next thing we have to do, always when one wants to calculate the band structure in the quasi-free electron model, is first one starts from the free electron in the ghost lattice, and for that one has to define, I mean, to find the basis, the U functions. So we need, in order to apply perturbation theory, to have the unperturbed state that we use as a basis for the perturbation later. So the basis for the free electron in the ghost lattice are the U function that are labeled with the reciprocal lattice vector. So they are normalized 1 over omega, where the omega is the unit cell volume of the aluminum FCC lattice. And then I have my exponential Jr, which I call this function just with that label G. All right, so these are the generic function in my basis, and I have to now use the G vector corresponding to my reciprocal lattice, which is a BCC lattice. So I have to generate the G vector, and I'm interested in the G vectors with the smallest length, because these are the ones that will give me the bands with the lowest energy. So I will order the G vector with increasing length. Norm, and I will do that for the case k equal to 0. For the other k, it's not going to be very different, because the k's are all inside the Brillouin zone, and therefore they are of length smaller than the first g vector that is non-zero. So I order my G vectors according to their length. So these are the G vectors, the type of the G vectors, and I group them according to their degeneracy at the k point, k equal to 0, at the gamma point. So G vectors, the first one is just this one for the reciprocal lattice of aluminum, and the degeneracy is 1. Then, since the reciprocal lattice is BCC, in the BCC I have 8 first nearest neighbor, so my G vector in the case of I was considering they are based on this primitive vectors of the reciprocal lattice. So one example here of the vector with next length is this one, 1, 1, minus 1, 2 pi over a, and I have 8 equivalent vectors that all points to the center of the cube around the origin. So, in reciprocal space I have a BCC lattice, and around the origin, so the BCC lattice around the origin, I have 8 nearest neighbor, and these are the coordinates of these 8 nearest neighbors. So minus 1, for instance, 1, 1, 2 pi over a, and so on. I have 8 of them. So my degeneracy at k equal to 0 is 8. Okay? And this is just, I told you that the reciprocal lattice was a BCC lattice with length of the cube 4 pi over a, and these are the 8 first nearest neighbor in this BCC lattice. All right? Yes? Okay. All right, so if I go then to the next shell of G vectors, so second nearest neighbor in my BCC lattice, these are just the points that are along edges of the cube. So this is, for instance, minus 1, 0, 0, 4 pi over A. And in the BCC lattice, I have 6 of these vectors that are of point second nearest neighbors. So in this case, there are 6, the degeneracy is 6, there are 6 of these G vectors. All right? So I will stop here. So these are the vector of the reciprocal lattice of aluminum. The reciprocal lattice is a BCC lattice, and these are the G vectors with the smallest length in this lattice, and these are the G vectors that are needed for my basis here, and that I should use for my basis because I'm calculating, I want to calculate first the bend structure for the free electron in a ghost lattice, and I have to use the lattice of aluminum. Alright, so now, like always in the quasi-free electron method, what I do first is to calculate the bend structure without with a constant potential. So, without V, meaning with a constant potential. So, I will take all V component, the Fourier component equal to 0. All right, so if I calculate my energy of the band at k equal to 0, so at the gamma point, so it's the free electron in the ghost lattice, my energies are just h bar square g square over 2m. So the energies I will obtain with the g vector 0, 0, 0, the first one there, the energy I will obtain is just epsilon equal to 0, h bar square g square over 2m is equal to 0. Then, if I look at the next energy, it will be obtained with the g, the next g vector, so with the 6, the 8 of the type 1, 1, minus 1, and so on. So also minus 1, 1, 1. So the 8 vectors here of that type will give me an energy epsilon, which is h bar square over 2m. And then here the norm of this vector square will give me 3 times 2 pi over a square. Okay? So this the first level will have energy 0. The second level will have this energy, and it will be of degeneracy 8, because I have 8 G vectors, so 8 band that at the gamma point will give me this energy. I will have 8 eigenstate. Okay? Excuse me?
I'm just...
Okay.
Those are the 8 bands that generate at k equals 0.
Yes. You are the first, but yes. Okay, all right. So, but this is only the three electron in the ghost lattice, so there will be no splitting. And okay, so this is what I have for the first two levels. Then I can also look at the next one, just to be more complete. So the next I obtained with this 6G vector, or this 6U eigenstates, of the type minus 1, 0, 0, 4 pi over A. So there are 6 of them, and they give in the free electron case energy h bar square over 2m. Then the norm square is 4 times 2 pi over A. I wrote it a little bit differently just to have the same energy unit. So it is 4 times 2 pi over 8, and in this case the degeneracy is 6. Okay, so this is at gamma, and we stop here. Then I will also calculate the energy at the x point. So at x, it is for k equal 2 pi over A 0, 0. So there I have to calculate the evaluate the energy, which is h bar square g plus k square over 2m. So what I will obtain first with g equal to 0, so the first g vector. So with g equal to 0, I will have just h bar square over 2m, 2 pi over A square as energy. But actually, this g vector, the 0 g vectors, gives me the same energy than these vectors, which is minus 1, 0, 0, 4 pi over A. If I add k to this, I obtain minus 2 pi over A, which is the same norm than when I add 0 to this vector. So I have a degeneracy 2 for these two vectors. I will obtain as energy epsilon h bar square over 2m, 2 pi over A square, and it's a degeneracy 2. I have these two u functions that give me the same energy in the quasi-free electron model. Okay, so this is the first energy level at x. Now the next one will be obtained with the g vectors of the type minus 1. And then I can have plus or minus 1 and plus or minus 1. So I'm using some of these vectors here, and I'm taking those that have in the as first coordinate minus 1 times 2 pi over A, because when I add the k vector here. So this is, sorry, here, it's 2 pi over A. When I add this, oops, I forgot the two. No, it's correct. I will obtain 0 as first coordinate, and then there will be the contribution of the other coordinate. So with this type of G vectors, I will obtain as energies epsilon is equal to h bar square over 2m. And then the second and third coordinate will be give me a norm 2 times 2 pi over b. And the degeneracy is 4 because I have 4 vectors plus or minus 1 here. So degeneracy 4. Okay? Everybody agrees? Okay. So this is for the energy levels I will obtain at the point X. And now in between, if I want to get the energy of the band, so along gamma x, I can write my k vector as lambda times 2 pi over a 0 0 with lambda between 0 and 1. So I'm going with the parameter lambda along the gamma x direction. When lambda is equal to 0, I have the gamma point, and when lambda is equal to 1, I have the x point. Okay, so in this case, the first band I will get starts from this level, so it's I have to consider just the G0 vector. So for this vector 0, 0, 0, I'm getting as energy in the free electron, because if I'm in free electron model, I'm getting lambda squared h bar square over 2m 2 pi over a square. Okay, this is my first band. And then for the vector g equal to, so the lowest energy I have then is this one at the x point, so I will start from there. That is when I have the g vector minus 1, 0, 0, 4 pi over a. The energy of the corresponding band will be epsilon is equal, so I have g, this g vector plus my k vector, which gives me lambda minus 2 square times h bar square over 2m 2 pi over a. So here I just put a 2 here, so minus 2 plus the one coming from, I mean, the lambda coming from here. So this is the energy of my first band. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. So now we continue. And the next vectors that I will consider are these vectors here. They give me the next energy, which is 2 times this, by the way, square. So if I consider the G vector of the type minus 1 and plus or minus 1 plus or minus 1 2 pi over A, I'm going to obtain as energy epsilon. So in this case I have minus 1 plus plus lambda, so it's lambda minus 1 square, the norm, plus the 2 that come from the other component for the norm, and h bar square over 2m times 2 pi over a. So this is the energy related to the next G vector. So the next 4 bands have this portion. Okay, so I think I will stop for the this portion here, and then I will just draw all this. So I'm looking along the kx direction, and I'm plotting the energy from gamma k equal to 0 to x, and the length here at x, so this is 0, and here the length is 2 pi over a. Okay. All right, so the first band has is just a parabola, and the value at kx equal to 0 is 0, and the value at here, what I will do is plot epsilon, and I will use as unit h bar square over 2m, 2 pi over a square, which is all the unit that I factorized here. So in this unit, at the point x, lambda is equal to 1, I have just 1 as energy. My energy will be 1. 1 times this h bar square over 2m, 2 pi over a square. Okay, so this is my first band, a parabola that goes from 0 to 1 at the point x, and this is a band that is associated with the g vector 0, 0. So we label it with these G vectors. It labels the functions U, the periodic part of the Bloch function for the free electron case. All right, so this is the energy at x of the first band. Now the next band goes from at the x point, it's the value of lambda is 1, so I'm going from 1 to the value when lambda is equal to 0, I obtain here 4. So the next 1, 2, 3, 4, this will be 4. So I will have a band that goes like this. And this band corresponds to the G vector of the type, there is just one, that is minus 1, 0, 0, 4 pi over a. So this is the band that is associated with this G vector that goes from 1 to 4. And then I have the last bands which have a degeneracy of 4. And what did I do?
It's here. It's at the top.
Ah, sorry, sorry. Thank you. Okay, so the last one at lambda equal to 1, I will have 2. So at the point x, I will have 2. And at the point gamma, that corresponds to lambda equal to 0, I will have 3. So, okay, and so it's a band that goes from 2 to 3. And so this is the band I'm going to get from the G vectors of the type minus 1, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 1. So there are 4 of them, pi over a. So this band has a degeneracy of 4.
I have a question.
Yes.
Looking at this, if we could have, instead of calculating the energies at the gamma and the x points, couldn't we have parameterized this straightforward and then work from there?
Just do this from there.
Yes, from there.
Yeah, but somehow it helps to have the values at the two limits. I mean, it's a question of preference, but it's less likely to make a mistake by having already checked, obtained the limit and then checking that one has. But yes, you could do it faster, but maybe there is a higher risk of making a mistake. But as you want. So this is the band structure. And now I want just to calculate the width of this band to compare to what was obtained from the density functional calculation in the band structure that I projected. So let's see. What is the width? Because the splitting at the x point, I mean, if you look at the picture, you can see that from gamma to x, it looks like a parabola with just a small splitting at the x point. So, grosso modo, if the free electron approach as a start is a good starting point, I hope that the width of the band will be consistent with what I obtain from the accurate calculations and the calculations. So let's evaluate the width from our model. So width of the gamma of the lowest gamma x band. So the width is just h bar square over 2m to pi over a square, and I will use the lattice parameter of aluminum. So the width is h bar square over 2m, and I will rewrite it to use Rydbergs, because in the scale here they have used also Rydbergs. So 80 square 2 pi over a divided by 80 square. So I just multiplied and divided by the same thing. So this is the Rydberg. And if I the A0 is the Bohr radius, so it's about half an angstrom, 0.529177 angstrom, so it's about half an angstrom. And A, we have seen that it's around 4, it's about 4. So this whole thing, if you evaluate, is about 0.67 Rydberg. So the width of the band is about 0.67 Rydberg, and if you look at the plot, the graduation are in 0.2 Rydberg, you indeed obtain something which is around 0.7 Rydberg. So it works. I mean, at least for the width of the band, we are doing well. So next time we will calculate the splitting. Okay, some questions?